morning and happy Sabbath. It's good to be with you and be back home. And there's a hymn that has been of encouragement to me that is 461, Be Still My Soul. I just wanted to read the lyrics. Sometimes we sing them, and when I'm singing, sometimes I forget what I'm singing. You know, you're just doing it as going through the motions. You know, be still my soul. But when you think of the words, be still my soul, the Lord is on thy side. Bear patiently the cross of grief and pain. Leave to thy God to order and provide. In every change, he faithful will remain. Be still my soul, thy best, thy heavenly friend, through thorny ways leads to a joyful end. Be still my soul, thy God doth undertake to guide the future as he has the past. Thy hope, thy confidence, let nothing shake. All now mysterious shall be bright at last. Be still my soul, the hour is hasting on when we shall be forever with the Lord. When disappointment, grief, and fear are gone, sorrow forgot, love's purest joys restored. I'm looking forward to that day so much. And it says that Elijah, in a moment of discouragement, saw the thundering, but the Lord was not there. And an earthquake, but the Lord was not there. And in this moment of discouragement, he was having a hard time to hear the still small voice. And I don't know what you're going through, you know, but there's moments when we go through those Elijah moments, you know. And I've been having a similar moment after doing a lot of ministry. You know, Elijah has that mountaintop experience, but then sometimes there's a moment where we have been going and pushing ourselves, and that we have a hard time to hear that still small voice. But I pray that together as I play this hymn, whether in a moment of discouragement, of sorrow, of grief, of disappointment, that we can remember that God is there, doth undertake to guide the future as he has the past.
Thank you. Financial planning for the mark of the beast time, part two. Part two. We'll just jump right into it. Our scripture, do we have a scripture reading? Psalm 37, verse 3. A promise for God to feed us. And a condition, too. And also in verse 25. There's a lot of scripture to have here written down, but let's just look at verse 3 and verse 25. I'm going to have maybe Billy. Would you read verse 3, Billy?
Trust in the Lord and do good, so shalt thou dwell in the land, and verily thou shalt be fed.
What a promise, right? Ted, you got verse number 25?
25 is, I have been young, and now I'm old. Yet I have not seen the righteous forsaken, nor his descendants begging bread.
Okay, so those are, and Psalm 37 is just full of these promises of God's promise to feed his faithful children. Some years ago, I remember we flew on an airplane, and I was working on a document on my computer, my laptop. And I became aware that the stewardess was standing right behind me, and she was eavesdropping on my computer. She's looking over my, just looking at this, staring at it with no apologies. I turned around and I go, "Beg your pardon," but she just kept looking at my computer screen. And she said, finally, she said, "We've got to get back to keeping the Sabbath, don't we?" And I said, "What do you mean?" Her name was Edna. I said, "What do you mean, Edna?" And she said, "I mean the Christian Sabbath, which is Sunday." "Oh, we do," I said. "We do, huh?" She goes, "Yes, we do." She said, "We need to contact our congressmen, our representatives, and lobby them so that they will make laws respecting Sunday worship. And we need to contact them and start promoting this because God is unhappy with us." And then she went on to tell me that the apparitions of the Virgin Mary, now where's the Virgin Mary right now? I call her the Virgin Mary. She's asleep in a grave, right? That's what the Bible says. So the apparitions and appearings all over the world of the Virgin Mary now are increasing. And her message to many in many places is that you need to start honoring Sunday and keeping the Sabbath. You know, Catholics call Sunday the Sabbath day. They treat it just like it's the Sabbath. Like we honor Sabbath, they honor Sunday. They call it the Sabbath. So the appearings of Mary increasing, and her messages are predominantly that we need to get back to keeping Sunday holy. Now in 1 Corinthians 11, verse 14, the Bible says, "No marvel, for Satan himself is transformed into an angel of light." And it's no wonder then if his agents, his ministers, are also transformed into ministers of righteousness. I mean, this is the Bible tells us that the devil is able to change his appearance, and he can appear as a person and he to deceive. And so there are voices clamoring for Sunday laws. This picture was taken by a car dealer in a big city, and he's joining a movement here. He made himself a really big banner. It's a Sunday we rest. And it's a big movement within this city for all business owners to shut their businesses down on Sunday and go to church and honor the Sunday, the Lord's Day. So that is just a localized movement, but there are worldwide movements. And I wrote down a few of them. You've heard of Dies Domini. That's a Catholic organization. Then you have the Evangelical Lord's Day Alliance, the Lord's Day Observance Society, and in Europe, the secular Europe, we have the European Sunday Alliance Group, and they're all clamoring for legislation to promote and keep Sunday, by law, to keep it holy, to keep it and rest on that day. And here in America, all these groups exist in our blessed America here. How long do you suppose our First Amendment will hold? Have you ever thought about that? Our First Amendment is like the most unique article in our whole Constitution. It separates the powers between church and state. It leaves it completely separate. Congress shall make no law respecting the establishment of a religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof. And that is just amazing. You get elements of that in some other governments, but nothing like this. America, by God's grace, was founded on religious freedom. And it's not going to be long when that religious freedom will be repudiated. So I believe, because of things like this, that the time is short and that we need to make hay while the sun shines. I would like to say it like that. Make hay while the sun shines. And, you know, there's time to pray and love each other and hug and do all these nice things. But this is a serious time we're living in. And, you know, I love to hear a preacher that will not beat around the bush and tell you what you need to do to be ready for Jesus to come. And so a book called 1888, an inspired messenger wrote, and page 872, I love these books when they have 800 pages or more. The book is called 1888. You do? 1880, okay, so on page 872 it says, "There must be no delay in getting the special warnings before the people. I have been shown it would prevent many from uniting in a petition to Congress to make Sunday observance a law." This is back in 1888 post and warning us that we really need to make hay while the sun shines. And that's a long time ago. Time is much shorter now. But this author writes under inspiration that's saying that we can actually unite and petition Congress to hold off the winds of strife. You know, we can delay it a little bit. So what did we learn from last time? Okay, so a few of you guys, how many were here for part one? Financial planning for the mark of the beast, part one. So a lot of you. Ted, were you not here? Let's see, Alex, we got to do the old trick here and get her started, fire it back up. So little quick review, Billy. Oh, I wish you were here last time, but I know you were ministering somewhere else. This will be our summary. Number one, every Protestant reformer we learned identified the Pope as the Antichrist, or the papacy, the seat of not the guy individually necessarily, but the seat of the Pope, the government of the papal office, as the Antichrist. But all churches, everyone except for one, has forgotten that. Okay, we learned that. We researched that out. Number two, we found out that the mark of the beast in Revelation 14 is the final test of mankind's loyalty on the earth. It's the very last thing, because the very next chapter 15, wasn't it? Did your Bible have 15 right after 14 in Revelation? Mine did too, and that's where the plagues fall. That means probation closes, time of trouble starts. And then there was a difference we discovered, and we unpacked this carefully because it's important. There's a difference between the mark of the beast time and the time of trouble. Some people have called this the little time of trouble, and this is the great time of trouble, or the great tribulation. Number four, there are Bible examples of God's people preparing to meet famine and crisis. God has called his people before a famine comes to prepare for it, because God does not like people to starve. The devil likes you to starve. If you starve and you blame God on it, you're blaming the wrong person. And number five, first, and the most, and this is the part that this is what brought this whole seminar into the Christ-centeredness. How many of you believe this is a Christ-centered message? I need to get you on tape. Can you record them saying that? Because people are saying, "What are you preaching about the mark of the beast and all this? Aren't you preaching the love of Jesus and forgiveness?" And I'm like, "Well, that's what we're doing." And this is a warning, but I need testimonies. I want you to let me know. Bear witness that this is a Christ-centered message, please. So the most important step before you even think about preparing financially or physically for the mark of the beast time is this. It was this. Be willing to die rather than disobey God. And we have Mark 8, Revelation 2:10, "Be thou faithful unto death, and you'll receive a crown of life." They love not their lives unto the death, right? And then Mark is, "He that would lose his life would save it, and he that would save his life would lose it." And so those are that's the review. And this was the most important thing. And every one of you that was here made the commitment. Now, I told you I wouldn't come back unless you made this commitment, because there's no need to prepare for the mark of the beast if you're not right here. You're not willing to die, lay your life down rather than be disloyal or unfaithful to God. There's no sense in, might as well just go back to singing our hymns, you know, and just and go to lunch, right? Right? I mean, that'd be fun, but this is important. Amen? All right, so back to number one now. Every Protestant reformer identified the Pope. This was so blatantly obvious years ago, and it's so, I don't know how the devil pulled this off. How many of you people know what an apple is? Two, three? No, just an apple. The thing you eat, that I eat, I have one a day. An apple a day keeps the doctor away. Well, I have an apple. We didn't have a whole apple today. I was in a hurry. But you should know what an apple, the same kind of thing applies here. We were in Elko, Nevada, traveling through, and it was the Motel 8, Super 8, a comfy place in Elko, Nevada. Boy. So we went down for the breakfast, the brunch thingy that they have, a little room, and there was a lady and her daughter there, and they were, well, anyway, they weren't in the healthiest condition. But the little girl, the mommy had an apple on her plate. And the little girl said, "Mommy, what's this?" She had no idea. Mommy said, "That's an apple." She said, "Oh, it has skin on it. Is it okay to eat?" Oh, yes, mommy said. And the little girl looked at it. She'd never seen an apple before, which probably explains a little bit of the health problem there's they had exuded. But anyway, we should know what an apple is, friends, right? You should know what an Apple computer is, right? I mean, you're also, an apple. We should know what an apple is. We should know, every Christian should know who the beast, I mean, it's so obvious. In your Bible, and everybody has forgotten, the devil has pulled the wool, just like we should know what an apple is. We should know who the beast is, because every single Protestant reformer has identified the papacy as the Antichrist beast of Revelation 13. Everybody has forgotten except for one group. Which group was that? The Seventh-day Adventist Church. All right, let's get reoriented. And this is our timeline. Remember this? And I doctored it up a little bit because this is so new. This seminar is so new, so I'm changing things all the time. And so, okay, so here we have our timeline. And this, of course, represents the mark of the beast, no buying and no selling time, right here. This is the time we're preaching about right here. Financial planning for that time, right there. And so here we are, up until this dotted line, we're preaching the everlasting gospel. We're about right here, and we're approaching rapidly to this point right here. And when the first phase of the Sunday laws are enforced, and that's going to be enforced with an economic boycott for those who don't receive the mark of the beast. And why does anybody remember why we have this line of demarcation right here? Perhaps, I think. That sounds good. I like it. This is the time of trouble, right? Now, see, we call this the time of trouble because that's what the Bible calls it. But, I think I may have mentioned this. This, I call the time of relief because up until, we talked about it in Hebrews 7. We have a high priest who is at the right hand of God, and he ever lives to intercede for his people, and he is able to save to the uttermost those that come to him through faith. And that's what's going on right here. Jesus is, and what happens when he gets right there? Then he's no longer interceding. He doesn't come till here, but right here, he takes off his priestly robes and he puts on his kingly robes. He stands up. Michael stands up. Daniel 12:1 at that time, he stands up. So this is a time of relief. And so here is our, and this is the time, this is the last testing time till that time of relief. It's the time of trouble. Right there. Probation closes, Revelation 7, 1, Revelation 22:11. Oh, right. Okay, that's right. That's right. Let he who is just be just still, who is he that is unjust. There's no more changing teams here. And so that's what I call the seven last plagues fall, and God's people go through a time of trouble, Jacob's time of trouble. We're stressing it out according to prophecy, whether our sins have been covered by all of our sins have been covered. But if you make it past there and no plagues, you look at your hands, no sores, you know, none of the seven last plagues are falling on you, a time of relief. I'm going to try to remember that because I'm going to fight that that stressed out feeling. I hate being stressed out. And I'm going to go, I'll take a big sigh of breath right here, even though the world is falling apart. Okay, so that's, any questions on the timeline? You know, I see somebody taking pictures, but that's our time. We'll refer back to this. But then we have the two phases here, no buying and selling. And then we have the second phase, Revelation 13, 15, death decree for those that won't receive the mark of the beast. If this doesn't work, this is what they're going to resort to. But thank God, is with all our research, and I collaborated with the E.G. White estate on this, William Fagel, and he says, yep, that's where it is. It's over here, past this. Thank God for that. And also, and now this is a little side note, a little rabbit trail, but you've heard about when Satan impersonates Christ, and that's going to be an overwhelming, overmastering delusion, and it's just going to be like, it'll just get everybody. As best I can study, and we'll have to make a sermon about that, that comes after here too. Praise the Lord. I mean, if it got here, we would have so many people that would be lost that might have been saved because it's an overmastering delusion. Okay, let's go to one more rehearsal, one more review, and that is our one-sentence definition of what the mark of the beast is. This orients us till we know what we're talking about, and it's in one sentence. You know, we spend Revelation seminars trying to explain the mark of the beast to people who've never heard it, but we just condense it down to one sentence, and we don't beat around the bush anymore. We don't have time to beat around the bush, so we just stay it like it is. This is the results of lots of study, but there it is, all condensed down. And we encourage people who have questions about this just to go to our website. You go right here on your phone, just type in desiremedia.org, click on Bible School. It'll go right to Revelation 101, and you can study this all out for yourself, and you'll see all the Bible texts and everything that bear this out. Revelation 101, and we wish we could advertise that more because not enough people use it. The mark of the beast is a sign of loyalty or allegiance to the Pope, demonstrated by observing Sunday instead of God's Sabbath at the end of time when its observance is enforced by a universal law that prohibits buying or selling for all those who won't observe this law. Whoever won't comply, they'll have a no buying and no selling. That's what the mark of the beast is. Does that make sense? It's all juiced down into that one little sentence. Now, this is not a guess. This is absolute 100% surety. And so, but we can study that out. You got to study that out. And it's important for us to know how to share this with others because this is redemptive for people when they learn it. In fact, this is what brought me into, I don't know if I necessarily became a Christian because of this, but this brought me into the love of prophecy. When I finally understood, it just made the Bible make sense. Well, that's the mark. Now, I get it now, I said, when I saw him with the mark of the beast. It makes so much sense. All the Bible just made sense then when I understood what the mark of the beast was. So let's go to our first question. Why is the mark of the beast, M-O-B, why is this test allowed? Why? So let's answer this question by asking, how/when are we judged? How and when is God's method of judging humanity? When does he do this and how does he do it? Well, to me, Hebrews 9:27 is a really good place to start to answer this. Here's a tomb of the unknown soldier. He's guarding him. Anyway, Hebrews 9:27, the Bible says, it is appointed unto man once to die, and then what? Then he's safe to, after this, the judgment. Then mankind is safe to judge. The normal way God will judge you, Penny, and me, is that he will let us live our lives, our 70 or whatever it is, a little bit more. We're going to go for 70, but unless the Lord comes before that. But that's the normal way. You live your life, and you can make choices, right? You can choose to follow God or not. And when you die, though, it's over. That's when you're... Your decision time is sealed. That's the normal way people are judged. So the vast majority of us live, breathe, die, and then God says it's safe to judge that person based on his life and his decisions, his choices. But what about those that are living when Jesus comes? How does this apply to those that are alive when Jesus comes? Does Jesus need to come down and kill everybody so that he can judge us? So the exception is this. There's an exception to this, isn't there? And the mark of the beast, period, it marshals all living people into one of two groups, either on God's side or the devil's side. That's the whole thing about the mark of the beast, isn't that right? The mark of the beast test, it hastens our decision one way or the other. The final movements are rapid ones, Jesus says, and we need to make a decision. God doesn't want to kill us all so he can judge us. He wants us to make a decision, and this is the decision. So God can judge us while we're still living. So you remember what Jesus said, and finish this sentence for me. Matthew 10:22, Jesus said, "He that endures to the end shall be saved," right? So endures, which means with patience. He that endures the onslaught of the devil's temptations, which will be really powerful. Just think about the mark of the beast time. That's what I'm trying to get us to think about, this mark of the beast time. It's a financial situation, the almighty dollar versus a love for God's word. And so, those that refuse the mark of the beast will get what? What do we get in Revelation? Get the mark of the beast and the other, the seal of God. Okay, so we get the seal. What is the seal of God? What is that seal of God? Have you heard that it's a settling into the truth? Yeah, it's when you're settled and committed, like we tried to get you to do in part one, a full commitment that no matter what, I'm on God's side. I'm going to obey and be loyal and faithful to God's word. When you're there, you receive the seal of God, right? I mean, it's not like, it's not like you withstood a few temptations there and, oh, finally made it. It's when you're there, you're willing to die rather than be moved out of your faith. A settling into the truth where we cannot be moved. 1 Corinthians 4, verse 5, the Bible says, "Judge nothing before the time until the Lord comes." So no judgment before the time. God's not going to judge us before until he comes or we die, one of the two. He says, "Who will both bring to light the hidden things of darkness and will make manifest the counsels of the heart." The mark of the beast time manifests what's in God, in your heart, in a rapid way. It's going to be kind of rapid. Now, if we're paying attention to God's word, we'll be keeping the seventh day holy, won't we? I mean, it's just pretty obvious. Now, if we're not paying attention to God's word and not heeding God's word, a substitute would do just fine, wouldn't it? Yeah. A man-made substitute. Now, I remember one time, speaking of getting it wrong here, and not paying attention. We were in a church in Redlands, California, and it was a big church, and we're milling out, kind of getting out of there. I'm trying to keep track of my wife, because there's so many people. I don't want to lose her. And so I'm looking at people and visiting and whoever, I can't just be watching her the whole time because I'm talking. People want to talk. And so I reach out and I grab a hold of her waist. That's an intimate place. You don't grab anybody but your wife there, Ted, right? And so I reach out, okay, I got a hold of her, and I start walking out and walking in the lobby and talking, and pretty soon I look down to say something to my wife, and it's not my wife. Ah. I wasn't paying attention. It was some young teenage girl. And she was looking at me the whole time. She wouldn't say a thing, bless her heart, but she was terrified. I mean, she was flushed. She was shocked that she was being assaulted in church by this strange man. A substitute does not do just fine. Pay attention. God is looking for us. That's like the test of loyalty. Who's paying attention to my word? God is. That's all he's given us, right? He has given us his word. How do we know Jesus? He is the word. He has given us his word, and there he is. He's in our Bibles, and he wants us to pay attention. Somebody once asked, how about loopholes? I love it when people do this. I don't love it, but it's funny. Will there be loopholes we can use to continue buying and selling for a while? I mean, is there something we can do? Maybe like, because what they're saying is this is going to happen suddenly, and all of a sudden we can't buy or sell, but maybe we could just delay a little while if there's a loophole. Like using a corporate card. Now, I often thought about this. Alex, have you thought about this? We have a nonprofit corporation that we work for. I wonder, what if, I got the mark. I don't have the mark of the beast, so I can't buy or sell, but what if that corporate card might still get us a bag of groceries once in a while, you know? Or maybe I can get somebody on the other side to buy some groceries for me, you know? Maybe a turncoat, you know? Like he's a trader, he'll help the other side. You think that's a good idea? To search for loopholes? So yeah, I don't know the answer to that, but I suppose those that are on opposite sides of the issue are not going to be friends. I mean, they're not going to be you. Just like this, you're the enemy, because like say in this vaccine mandate thing, you know, there's a lot of people that promote the vaccine mandates. They hate the people that don't want to get the vaccine. They absolutely hate you, and they want to fire you from your job. They want to force you to get the vaccine, and I'm not. You know, I'm not against the vaccine, but they definitely are against. There's a chasm. There's a divide there, and that's a small scale compared to what it will be like at the mark. Because you're going to be enemy number one if you will not receive the mark of the beast. It's not going to.
They wouldn't turn you in.
Yeah, we'll turn you in. Yeah, but so we're talking about the time of no buying and economic boycott. So you're already turned in. You don't have to worry about them turning you in. You can't buy or sell. Unless you receive the authorization. Yeah, you're toast. But that's what we're doing in our seminar. I think this is the whole idea. This is the in-service the churches need. And until Ted Wilson tells me to stop preaching this stuff, we're going to keep preaching it until every church hears this. And so, because we want people in the churches to know what to do, what's coming. You wouldn't believe the ignorance about the mark of the beast and how they don't even think about it. Oh, boy, I don't want to think about that. Oh boy, God will take care of us though. You know? And then they just totally put it out of their mind. My advice is to be careful when searching for loopholes. You end up being like the Pharisees. You know, and Adventists fall into this trap. So there was when I was in Loma Linda, you were in Loma Linda. You know what Hospitality Lane is? Hospitality Lane is in San Bernardino. That's where all the restaurants are, and that's where people go to eat lunch. There's the China Palace, and there's all these great, you know, Fridays, and all these great restaurants. This is where people so in Hospitality Lane, they're not getting much business on Saturdays. They notice, so they made a little coalition. I don't know how they did this, but apparently they made a little coalition and talked to the people in church and said, "You can come and eat on Sabbath here, and we won't bill your credit card until later." And people fell for that. Now the restaurants are full of Adventist church. They go to the churches. There's lots of churches down there. They'll go to church, and then they go, "Well, I guess, you know, it's buying and selling on Sabbath. Hey, I like this one." They all go. They're going to go eat. Well, we don't have to go home and cook. And so they go out to eat on Sabbath, and with thinking, that's a loophole. You know, it's a Pharisaical loophole, right? It has nothing to do with buying. That God's commandment doesn't have anything to do with buying. I mean, it does, but that's one aspect of it. But the Bible tells us not to have our manservant, our maidservant work for us. Everything within our jurisdiction is to rest. We rest, and we don't have anybody work for us. And so here you have a Pharisaical loophole, and God, I don't think God's happy with us searching for loopholes. You know, in Daniel chapter 6, what is Daniel 6 about? Does anybody know the theme? The lion's den, right? Now you see a law was made that you can't bow down and pray to any god except for the king for 30 days. Now I can think, if I was Daniel and knowing that you're going to go to the lion's den, I could think of some loopholes on this one. Did Daniel even hint about looking for a loophole? Like maybe I could shut my windows and pray. I could shut the windows. I could just, when they ask me if I'm praying to Jehovah, I'll just won't answer them. I'll just, I don't know. Now, this is an example for God's people at the end of time. Don't even think about loopholes, but let your light shine for Jesus. So Daniel opens up his windows and said, "Well, I'll go to the lion's den then, you know, if that's what it takes." And that's what we were when we talked about our commitment. Be thou faithful unto death, and you'll receive a crown of life. So be careful for looking for loopholes. I hope that that helps. I bet this is going to help somebody in the last days, because a lot of us are going to be going, oh, yeah, I'm not quite prepared. What do I do? Where's the loophole? And you're going to think about what we just talked about here, and you're going to say, no thank you to loopholes. You remember this is a testing time, right? You like test time? You like when the finals in Loma Linda University, I remember finals with our infamous scale score and the competitiveness that goes on there. And we like extra credit because it helps. This is your final test. You want to score high on your final test, the final test of life. And I think you like Daniel, you should go for some extra credit. Throw your windows open. Let your light shine. I mean, you don't invite trouble, right? You don't go out and if they say, don't work on Saturday, don't mow your lawn, you don't go out there and just fire that lawnmower up and rev it as high as you can and say, look at this. But let your light shine, because there's others watching you and making decisions, and you can be a minister to somebody else. And God will shut the lion's mouths. He puts you in the time of trouble, but he cares for you, and he provides. You know, God provides. I love the stories. I got stories, but I remember one time our well went out. See, God provided a country home for us, and we'll talk about location next time. Our part three is going to be about location and where God wants us to be. Well, we're already kind of, I'm pretty sure we're where God wants us to be, because he won't let us leave. We try to leave. We squirm, and he has, nope, right there. You're safe. Now, don't mess with it. Well, there's a lot of things to country living, right? You got to take care of yourself. We have a well where we get water for ourselves. We don't buy water from the city, because there's no city anywhere. But there's our well. One day, our well went out, and that was not good. I said, God, what happened to our well? I walked out there, and it had a short. I didn't know that it had a short, but it had electrical short in the wiring, and I don't know what I'm going to do. And right when I'm praying about what to do, an electrician drives into the yard. A neighbor that lived in the area, George, remember George? He's not there anymore, but he pulls into the yard, and he is an electrical contractor. I go, praise God. And then I go, well, I don't know what's wrong with it. And he's looking at it and thinking about it, and George is looking in there, what's going on here? And he was having trouble figuring it out. So what did God send? Another electrical engineer stopped by. Another neighbor who happened to be an electrical engineer, he stopped in there, and he got the thing. Oh, he said, right here. And he started rewiring everything and fired that thing up. And we had water just within about an hour when it went out. And I said, thank you, God. Not only that, George, the first electrician that couldn't fix it, he wanted to know, how much you want for that old plow out there? I had this piece of junk plow that was left on our property, an iron thing, and he wanted it for a decoration. I said, $300, we're asking, and he goes, well, there's $300, I'll come get it. And so we made $300 on the deal, too. That was kind of nice. God provides. He provides. Next question. Now, we're getting into the sermon now. Will debt hurt me? What if I, in the Mark of the Beast time, will debt hurt me? I almost laughs asking this question, because what if I owe money on my home? What if I owe money on anything? Will debt hurt me? Let me start with this. Inspired quote from a publication years ago, 1865. That's the time that Abraham Lincoln emancipated the slaves, right? 1865? Something like that. Okay, Adventist Review and Herald, this is about debt. And this is like a no-brainer. Debt, in a poetic way, the author writes, is to man what the serpent is to the bird. Its eye fascinates, its breath poisons, its coil crushes sinew and bone. Its jaw is the pitiless grave. If you mock my illustration, if you sneer at the truth it embodies, give yourself no further trouble to learn how to manage your money. Just consider yourself doomed. Why did the author write this? This is nothing new, you know. This is what the Bible teaches. This is inspired commentary on what Solomon wrote in Proverbs 22. The borrower is slave to the lender. How many of you have loans? I shouldn't even ask you that, because you're going to feel like, oh, I'm a slave. I am debt free. Okay, I'm bragging now, but because God wants me to be debt free. Now I did get a loan. I shouldn't even share this. I wouldn't share it except it's Chiloquin. I needed a tractor and John Deere. My other tractor quit, and you're on a farm, you need a tractor, and I didn't have a million. You know, those are expensive things, but they hold their value. So I had to get a loan. Should I even share this with him? I shouldn't do this. Too late now. Got a tractor. My tractor couldn't get it started, and then we found out that John Deere will buy your old tractor. This the government will buy it from you for lots of money just to get it out of circulation because it makes pollution. They want you to buy a new one that has no that has all the DEF stuff and you know all that stuff. And they are offering an amazing incentive. Plus, zero financing, nothing down. My down payment was my tractor. They gave me $22,000 for this piece of junk tractor. And then they gave me a brand new tractor with a cab and heater and air conditioning and big engine and no money. I haven't paid a cent for that. I got that a long time ago, and I haven't paid anything on it yet. I got some oil for it once. But they got my tractor, and the government gave them $22,000. It's interest-free, though. Well, let me just stop there. But it's interest-free. It's worth way more than I owe. So this, I am technically in debt for that tractor. But other than that, and we'll talk about which debts are cause liability during this time or not. But the borrower is slave to the lender. I could pay it off right now but why pay it off? It's 0% interest, you know. And so, you know, it's just, why should I give them the money to hold when I can just hold it myself? Anyway, the borrower is slave to the renter. You recognize this face? Yes. That's Dave Ramsey, right? And he has a thing called Financial Freedom University or Financial Peace University. And he encourages people to get out of debt for secular reasons. He doesn't even know what the mark of the beast is. Nobody seems to know anymore, but he encourages people to do this to their credit cards. Get rid of this debt, and because debt is bad. It causes you to be a slave to the lender. And how many of you have listened to his program, and you've heard the people that call in, and they get to proclaim when they're debt-free, and they scream it, I'm debt-free, and then they have a big celebration, and he gives them gifts, and blah, 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 and they're so excited about being debt-free. And he celebrates that because debt crushes you and it enslaves the borrower. And never more can this be said of a time more than of the time of the mark of the beast. The mark of the debt will come up to crush you during the mark of the beast. Now let's take a look at a typical U.S. family. You know, in the United States, we love debt, don't we? Oh man, we live to keep up with the Joneses. And the bank supports us in this, right, Crystal? It's so easy to get a loan now. I mean, I'm a pauper. I don't have anything, but look at, they gave me a John Deere, a brand new tractor. I just don't understand that. But I don't owe anything on my house. Make all our vehicles paid for. Let's look at, here we have Dave and Gigi Parker. Good friends of mine, and they're fictitious. They live right there. See that house? It's a tract home in Southern California. And here's their little song they sing every day. I owe, so off to work I go. They're Sabbath keepers. They believe in God's Ten Commandments, and they keep the Sabbath in Southern California. Their debt includes a mortgage on that house. And houses are pretty expensive in Southern California. They owe $371,981 on their home. That's a lot of money, isn't it? I mean, you come to an area like this and you can get acres and acres of land for that kind of money, right? But this is here we have a quarter of an acre with a tract house on it. Not a very big house. It's about 2,500 square feet, maybe. That's a pretty good size, but they got two kids, you know, they each have their own bedroom, but they owe a lot of money. They pay $2,418 a month for their mortgage. They have car loans. They each have a car because they each work. And so So their mortgage balance is actually right on par with the average in the United States, or maybe it's California. The average mortgage is $371,981. Right on par. They're right there. They owe that much. They, along with 37% of the other people in the United States, have a car loan. 37% of people in the United States have a loan on a car, with the average balance, get this, $31,142. They owe a lot of money. You know, we don't even have a car worth that, do we? I mean, not even close. I'd like that, but I want an electric car now. You know, until we can get the goose that laid the golden egg back in the White House, I want to get an electric car where we pay less for energy. $31,000, and the average payment is $577 a month for their cars, and they have two of them. And then they have other debts. They got the credit card. They got a few credit cards, and they have a school loan. These kids go to a Christian school, and they have a phone bill, which is a monthly payment. They have toys. And the two toys they have are a boat and a RZR a Razor. Alex, don't you want one of those? Well, you couldn't. They wanted one. And side by side little things, ATVs. How many of you have one of those? I shouldn't. He does, and they love that thing. I bet he has a trailer for it, probably. Yeah, I see people going by all the time. They come by, and they got their big Ford diesel truck, and they got that trailer and their RZR in the back. Boy, they're heading out to the mountains to have a good time. That thing's expensive. It's about $25,000 for one of those things. Well, they wanted one so bad, they didn't have the $25,000, so they borrowed it because the guy would loan it to them. A Honda dealer, whoever, the Polaris dealer, he loaned them the money. They're in debt. Now, question, will debt hurt the Parkers when the Mark of the Beast time comes, when you cannot buy or sell unless you accept the mark? Will debt be a problem for them? Here they are right there, $371,000 in debt. Somebody else owns their home, really. And so the answer is yes, right? What happens when you don't make your payment, when you don't make a payment on something that you owe money on? It goes bye-bye, right? Here's some people saying bye to their car. And here's a rule of thumb that we should maybe listen to. This is financial planning for the Mark of the Beast time. Whatever is secured by a debt will be forfeited in the Mark of the Beast time, unless you accept the Mark of the Beast. Example, a car. This car they borrowed money on, and they didn't pay. These people didn't pay for it. But in the Mark of the Beast time, you don't have money that you can use. No more. Your money's no good, and you can't pay for it. So whatever is secured by a debt will be forfeited. Now, how could the Parkers, how could they avoid something like this happening to them? When the Mark of the Beast hits, how could they avoid getting that guy to repo their car? Yeah, don't owe money on it. That's the one good option, right? The other option is the one that most people will probably take, and that is accept the Mark of the Beast so they can use their money. That's why Jesus said to the rich young ruler, how hard it is for a rich man to get into the kingdom, because your money is so important to you. So the temptation for those Parkers, they paid a lot of money on that house. They got money into their cars. They've things invested in it, and some of those things are close to being paid off. It'd be a shame to lose it now. So the temptation to accept the Mark of the Beast is going to be a huge thing. Money will be a problem for you if you have it. And so a goal, I'll just skip forward, a goal for us during the Mark of the Beast time is to spend all your money, or try to time it. You don't know when that's going to happen, but if God could help us, we'll time it just perfectly. So we've spent everything on the gospel and on securing help for ourselves and for others before that time occurs.
Mm-hmm. To let all of that go.
Yeah. If they're in debt. Yeah, and a lot of the. Yeah, that's if they owe money on it, it's not theirs. It's only theirs if they pay for it, if they keep making those payments, then it's theirs. There's going to be so many people And I lived in Loma Linda, Southern California, in a tract home, and those homes are very expensive. You know, and when the economy does something weird, the value goes way up. I mean, our neighbors, they bought a house, our next door neighbors, they're in a tract home, they bought a house, $300,000, something like that, and then something happened with the economy, and all of a sudden, boom, it was worth $600,000. And now, boy, they have most of it paid for, you know. Can you imagine? They have so much invested into this. If they could just pay. Yeah, you got a question?
Okay, so they decide to follow Jesus. That's the right thing to do, even though they weren't actually doing that to begin with. But they decide.
But they're like everybody.
Everything is going to be gone. Their home, their toys, everything. So that means they're going to move in with you, right? They have to go somewhere.
Well, I got that coming up here. So I need a really big house, right? Well, most people, I'm afraid to say this, but I don't think we're going to have that big of a problem because most people will succumb and comply with the mandate for Sunday worship. That's a sad thing to say, but that's what they're going to do. So just imagine the pressure that debt will put on God's saints. So the goal is get out of debt, right? Get out of debt. We have a friend in Colorado, and this is kind of similar on a similar line, but she wouldn't get the vaccine. She didn't want the vaccine. So her employer really wanted to, he offered her $1,000 if she would get the vaccine. Please get the vaccine. I'll give you $1,000. And she still said no, bless her heart. But I would have said $1,000 for a vaccine. I mean, I got to do a little research, make sure it's not going to hurt me. But anyway, she was so sure that's the wrong thing to do. But the pressure, financial pressure to comply with the mark of the beast is going to be enormous. And debt will put that pressure on you. So if you don't comply, you can lose your home, you'll lose belongings, you'll lose friends. Losing a car is bad. So you lose your car, shoot, lost my car. But which debt of the Parkers is worse? What would be the worst thing for them to lose? All right, yeah, foreclosure is the worst case scenario. That's the thing that is really bad. Now, some debts may not even hurt the Parkers, like the school loans. Like they got the loan for the school and their school. You know, they graduated at Loma Linda University. They got this huge debt. You got to pay that thing off. And pray for my Carter. Somebody prayed for a Carter today. Was it you?
Grandson.
Your grandson, Carter. Yeah, I almost had pray for my car. He just moved to Walla Walla now and getting ready for school, and he's going to have debt, poor guy. But, school's important. So school loans, credit card debt may not be a crushing thing unless you have it secured by something else. Property investments like a second home, etc. Some debts may not hurt as bad as others, but your primary residence is not one of those debts that will not hurt you. That will hurt you. If you owe money on your home, and you don't want the mark of the beast, this is going to be a problem. Question.
Okay, so you own everything, but if you start thinking about it realistically, you're not going to be able to pay your land taxes even if you own that.
We're getting there.
Yeah, 3 years.
This is financial planning to the market. We don't leave anything out. Don't worry about that. So the main goal, though, Crystal, in this for this idea here, is don't owe money on your home. And I know that sounds hard, right? That sounds really difficult, but God can provide this if you start praying and start focusing. You know, Dave Ramsey has all these stories where people, impossible for them to pay off their mortgage, but they get it done when they focus on it. And God's, with God's help, you can do that. You can actually do this. Say, God, I can see a problem coming. I owe money on my home. What should I do? And then start praying and start listening for God's guidance and make that a goal. Just don't owe on your home, on your primary residence. Do you lose your home? If you lose your home, it's not still, if you do lose your home in this time, remember this. It's not the worst thing in the world. It won't be the worst. You could be like Scott here. I met this guy. He bought a vehicle from our ministry. We were selling a truck or something that we didn't need anymore. Look at this. I don't know why he shared this with me, but I blocked out his address, his driver's license number. Here's his address, Walmart parking lot. The DMV in Oregon issued him, I'm homeless. Well, where do you live? We have to have an address. Well, I live in the Walmart parking lot. Put that down. That's your address. Walmart parking lot 1360 in wherever that is. Central Medford. That's where he lives. He said, I said, you mind if I take a picture of your driver's license? This could be handy in a seminar. So there may be some saints that are willing to sell their home at the last hour just so they can put money into the gospel work. And bless those saints, because they want to put money into God's work. They can say, my home's not going to do me any good. Let's sell it. Let's put the money into Bible study interests and reaching out to people to save souls before our money's no good. Put the money into the Lord's work before the mark of the beast time comes. So, yes.
I have a friend that is dead now, but he did that four times. Sold his farm. Four times. Different farms that God gave him. And he gave it all to print material and send it around the world.
Sold his home. But he mean he got a loan on it or just sold it?
No, he sold it. And he got another one. He sold it. He got another four times.
Wow. So it sounds like that the Lord was blessing him. Did you know that when you give, the Bible says the liberal soul shall be made fat, which means prosperous. You give money to God's work and you will not, guarantee you, you will not be able to outgive God. You put it into God's work, he'll put it back into you. Because, well, boy, this is a fountain. It's amazing that God can do this. So what will happen when your spending is cut off? Okay, you got your spending cut off. Can you expect mercy from your landlord? Now, we're going to go into a little bit of those kind of issues. So you're telling your landlord, I can't make my payment. Is there, your bank probably. I can't really make the payment. And what do you suppose your landlord's going to say? Yes, you can, right? He's going to say, yes, you can. You go down there and you go to that priest and you tell him, give me the authorization. Show up to church on Sunday, right? That's easy. Why are you being so obstinate and non-compliant? You will not be able to expect mercy from your landlord. You'll be on the opposite end of your landlord's unless. So you can't. Can you expect mercy from your landlord? I would say, generally speaking, no. Christian's going, what have I gotten into here? Where has he gone off the deep end, Larren? And what about if your landlord refuses the mark of the beast also, right? Then maybe there's some hope there, right? Say your landlord is a Sabbath keeper and he's refusing the mark. Well, then you're in good shape then, right? You owe money to him and he can't pay it either. So hopefully hopefully it's paid off with him. And so a little tip, this is not that important, but if you must borrow, try to borrow from a fellow believer. Is that okay to say that? There's problems with people borrowing from, can I have 10 bucks, Billy, and I'll pay you back, and then I don't pay you back. Then all of a sudden we're in it, you're not nice to me anymore. Yeah. It didn't happen with us, by the way, but it happens, yeah.
Usually the ones that don't return the money to you get
away from you. Yeah, right. I know. And so you estrange your friendship and your relationship. It could strain things, but if you can... Say if Christian's selling a house and I'm thinking he's gonna loan me the money to buy it, I'll buy it from Christian rather than buy it from the bank because he's if this kind of happens here, the mark of the beast time comes, he's probably gonna be more merciful to me, right? You want to borrow from someone who also will refuse the mark of the beast, and we'll talk about this in part three, I think, more about how to assess people on which side they're on. So the same thing applies for renting. A lot of us probably don't own, and a lot of us may rent. This will only work if the landlord owns the property free and clear, right? If you're renting from a landlord who will refuse the mark of the beast too, he's a Sabbath keeper, he's a believer in God, and he refuses it too, and he owns the property free and clear, well, maybe that's a safe place to be for a while. So here's the goal. Try to be debt-free in your home, and God can help you do this. God will open the door. God will open doors for this. He did it for us, but I'll share that next time. Next month, I guess we'll be back. What is better, renting or owning? Can anybody help me answer this?
Owning.
Period. Owning, period. If you have a choice and you can get a home that you own, that's a better. That is better. Owning is better than renting. In fact, owning is cheaper than renting. I don't know why people even bother with rent. Oh, I don't have the down payment. Well, there's people that loan you the down payment nowadays. It's easy to get a mortgage now. In Southern California, we rented an office / home for a while when we needed to be down there. Rent was $2,500 a month for the house. You could have bought it for $1,800 a month, but we didn't want it. But so anyway, but owning is better, period. Here's what the author of Last Day Events wrote. Now listen to this. You read this probably before. Some of you have heard this. Fathers and mothers who possess, which means to own, not rent, if they possess a piece of land and a comfortable home, they are what? Kings and queens. Why does the author say this? Is she saying these people that own property out in the country, that means they're royalty, nobility? No, that's not at all. And what it means is they govern, and to a certain extent, they govern themselves, self-govern themselves to a certain extent. Our experience living in the country during the COVID thing, it had almost no effect on us at all. Because we are kings and queens. We own a country, basically. Our land is a country. Not very much. It's 32 acres. Has a creek on it. It's got two wells on it, and it was super cheap when we bought it, and we have it paid off. We are kings and queens because we govern the place, and no government comes in there and says, well, you got to wear a mask, and you ought to get a vaccine, and you got to go to church on Sunday. Nobody, they don't do that in the country. They want to, they would try to. They do that in the cities. This is what, where you're all sheeped into this little city here. This is where a tyranny and oppression come in the form of government. But when you own property, a comfortable home, you govern yourself to a certain extent. Here's another related question. You own your home debt-free, what about property tax? It's right on there. Property tax. Isn't that awful that you don't really own your home when you own it? How many, I shouldn't ask, I don't want to know, because I do want to know, but I want to know how many people are debt-free, but I don't dare ask you because embarrassing. I don't embarrass anybody. But if you own your home, you still owe annual property taxes. And what a shame. Now, in my county, you pay county property taxes. I own land in Modoc County, California. And the administrator of Modoc County is a Seventh-day Adventist. He's the elder of a church that we film in, that we film stuff in, and our kind of like we belong to Lakeview, but our home church really is, don't tell anybody, it's Cedarville. And so we sneak over there, and with this administrator is a Seventh-day Adventist. He's the guy that gets our property tax money now. And so here I am talking. I said, I'd like to petition our local government to eliminate property taxes. He said, he laughed. That'll never happen. That's what funds our government, our property taxes. So you're not going to probably get anybody talked into eliminating property tax. But he says, hey, are you worried about, the mark of the beast when you can't buy or sell? So if I were you, I wouldn't even worry about that. In Modoc County, it says it'll take me 5 years to get you off your property once you stop paying. You stop paying your mortgage? I can't get you off your property for about 5 years. That's a long time, isn't it? You have to go through all the little hoops and the rigmarole and this and that, and God will just trip them up and if need be. 5 years. I also asked the county assessor, I said, can I pay in advance? I didn't say, I'm trying to anticipate the mark of the beast here, lady, and help me out here. I asked if I could pay in advance. No, we don't take advance payments. I wanted to pay as much, I want to empty my bank on my property tax. I want to pay up 20 years. Well, not in Modoc County. Call them and ask them. They might take property tax payments early. Now, there is a company I found who works for military. And the military people that are overseas for years at a time, they pay bills for them. And you can use those companies. You give them money and deposit your money and say, now, on this due date, you pay this bill, and they'll just pay it, and they'll charge a small fee. I don't know if that would work out or not, but if you trust them enough to make a property tax payment for you, you could always do that. Now, there are 13 states I researched in the United States that have no property tax for senior citizens, and I'm rapidly approaching that age. I'm right there. Bill, you're getting there too. You're right behind me. 13 states, and for instance, Washington, get this, in some counties, if you're 61 years and older, you don't pay property tax anymore. That's what I wanted in Modoc County. I said, if we owned our property for 20 years and we turn 65, how about giving us a break on our property tax? I'm sure everybody would vote yes on that. Government would try to silence you. But anyway, so that, I hope that helps with the property tax question. That's all I got. Somebody once told me Puerto Rico doesn't even have property tax. I looked it up yesterday. It's not true. They have property tax now. I'm saying you should. I'll tell you that next presentation. I'll tell you to move on that one. Yeah, yeah. Well, whenever we come. No. This is something you pray about yourself. I'm not going to give any advice on what you should do specifically.
I'm having a slight meltdown here because of the fact that my friends Jan, Ron, and Warren.
Yeah. Well, most people are, you know. Yeah. Well, you got a goal now. $38,000. You can do it. You can pay that off with God's help. That'll be a goal for you. That should be something you should be praying about. Yeah. You're not, if you've made a commitment to Christ, to Jesus, no matter what, I'll be homeless, I'll die, whatever it takes, I'm going to be loyal. You may be uncomfortable, but you're not going to be toast. What if Jan and Rob, turn on you? What if they decide to take the mark of the beast, though? When you're following Christ's direction, now this is above all that we're saying. Follow Christ's directions, and you're okay, no matter what. He's going to guide you and lead you, and you may go. We're going to be uncomfortable, no matter how much we've prepared. We're going to be uncomfortable, but let's go. Okay. What about selling? Oh, you guys don't give me enough time. This is a key question in financial planning. This is a key question. The mark of the beast time is a time when your financial assets become worthless, okay? So what should our goal be here as far as if you have some money in the bank or you have some assets, knowing that the time of no buying and selling is coming, what should be a goal? It should be pretty obvious, right?
Spend,
exactly right. You want to spend, and if you could time it just right. I heard Ed Reed one time, you know, the financial guy, Ed Reed. He's the, Yeah, Ed Reed, he's financial something. He says the goal of the Christian is to have all your money spent and time it so that right before Jesus comes, and he meant the mark of the beast times enforced, you have it all gone. You spend it all. And you go into that time. And God, here, look at this quote. Maranatha, 183, the time is coming when we cannot buy or we cannot sell at any price. Those who are loyal to God will see every earthly support cut off. God calls for us now to do all in our power to send forth a warning to the world. Unwrap your napkins and send your talents to the exchangers that when Christ shall come, he may receive his own with interest. So now is the time to start, communicate with God, figure out how am I going to unload my, I got some assets. Like I own my home. Should I sell it and use the money? I use my whole life for the gospel, so I put the home is the gospel, and it is used as a ministry office. And so you want to be right here. So you want to time it if you can. God will help you with your timing. So there's one thing that has priority over our personal needs, and that is the gospel. The gospel needs. Sometimes it's finances that the gospel needs. We need to position ourselves for this end time testing, and we need to also aid in others, but priority comes to Christ and the gospel. So how do you know when to sell? How do you know about the timing? Do you think God can teach us that? Or is he going to say, oh, you have to guess it. I'm not going to tell you. Is God going to do that? You pray, and like in James 1:5, there's a promise with a condition, right? If you lack wisdom, if any of you lack wisdom, let him ask God who giveth liberally. Right, James? There he is right there, James. And so, and he'll give it to you. So you ask God, when should I sell and how much should I sell? Counsels on Stewardship, number page 60. If they desired to be taught, God would teach them in a time of need when to sell and how much to sell. If you sincerely desire that, he'll tell you. He'll tell you. So, the primary reason why is to invest in the gospel. So the next logical question is, all right, so we're investing in the gospel. Can I actually win souls during the mark of the beast time? Can we win souls during the mark of the beast time? Thank you. We know that's a good question. And let's see if we can answer it. All right, can we win souls during the mark of the beast? The answer is yes, right? And that's what this whole time is all about. This is decision time. People are going to be making up minds. So when does decision time end? Right there. Remember this? Decision time. So this is when the time starts, and we don't know how long that's going to be, but it ends right there. Yeah, that's the end of probation. Your ability to use money, if you're on God's side, ends right there. And your ability to choose salvation, the end of probation, it ends right there. This is a pretty big timeline. That's a big dotted line, isn't it? It's significant. It's Daniel 12 tells us, at that time, Michael will stand up, and there shall be a time of trouble such as never was. When Jesus stands up, he is ceasing his intercession for man. And the gospel work has to be done before this. That's my whole motivation for ministry, is the gospel work has to be done before that line. And I want to get it done. I don't want to wait till we get into that red zone. I don't want that, because I want to make hay while the sun shines. So when we get into that period, that red zone, no buying, no selling, it's going to be really tough to convince somebody, to try to plead with somebody and appeal to them to give their lives to Christ. There'll be a shaking time, right? A lot of Adventists are going to go out of the church. A lot of non-Adventists will be coming into the church. It's going to be a quick little shuffle, like the card shuffle. Whoa, we got a whole new deck here. It'll be surprising to everybody. So I'd prefer to get this work done, if possible, before this happens. You know, I hate doing work when we're being persecuted. You know, I heard a story about George Vandeman. You remember George Vandeman? He started It Is Written. He's given a Bible study to a lady in a home. And the lady's husband was an alcoholic drunk. He didn't want George there. He came out and was keep interrupting. He's preaching the gospel and doing the Bible study with her and coming to her home. One day, the man came in there, and he was drunk, and he took a bottle, a wine bottle, and told him to get out of the house and clobbered George Vandeman on the head. Didn't knock him out, but it gashed his head. He didn't get out. The woman says, you know, she was just terrified. So they dressed his wound up, got his wound all, and they went right back to the Bible study. And the man became converted after that. That converted the man. The persistence of the Bible worker converted the man. The work we fail to do in a time of peace, which is now, will have to be done under the most discouraging and forbidding circumstances. You might get hit on the head with a wine bottle. I want to do it before the wine bottle comes out. Okay, we're going to have to skip around a little bit, but I want you to do some homework for me before I come back next time. What can a local church do to help its members? The church is an asset for its members. Think about this. What can the church do to help its members, their survivability in this time, you know, during the Mark of the Beast time? And we'll talk more about this, but I want to solicit some answers, and you'll think about this. Just think about our three basic needs And Matthew 6:33 talks about it. It says, seek ye first the kingdom of God, and all these things will be added unto you, the shelter, your water, and your food. That's what Jesus promises us, Matthew 6:33. Our three main needs, food, water, and shelter. And the church can be God's tool for Jesus to keep this promise. You know, one time our church, for instance, in Lakeview, we had, you know, every once in a while a member would come in and they'd be hungry. A visitor would come in. And I thought, well, you know, sometimes we don't have a potluck and we don't have anything to feed them. Why don't we take some of our church budgeted money and we'll go and we'll buy some really healthy food. And I thought vegan food was the way to go, you know. So we budgeted $150 and they sent me down to Trader Joe's in Reno to get food. $150, and I went down. I was looking for anything that looked healthy and edible and yummy. I just threw everything in the cart, and I didn't add up anything. I went right to the grocery line, and I said, oh, that's all I can get there, and it was heaping. And it rang up to $150 exactly. Well, off maybe a 10 cents or something off, but it was right there, $149.99 or something like that. And I think God was kind of in that in a little bit. You know, sometimes God keeps ahead of you financially. But I think the church needs to be like a Joseph to its members. We talked about this. Bill, you missed this, but we talked about the Bible's examples of God helping his people prepare for famine. The famine was sore all over all the face, and Joseph opened up the storehouses and sold. The time was 7 years, wasn't it? 7 years of famine that God had prepared for the people. Through Joseph, he prepared. They stored food for that long. So God used Joseph to fulfill a plan to sustain God's people during a time of crisis. Can he use the church in the same way? The church should think about maybe making a plan for its members. And we'll talk. We have to wait to talk about this until part 3 and 4, but especially part 4. You'll see why later. All right, last question. Will God let me starve to death if I refuse the mark of the beast? Oh, okay, now that's a good text. But now that text, it may have a little bit of element to do with the time of mind, but it's the time of trouble that Isaiah is talking about there. Or maybe I'm not quite as prepared as I should be. Will I starve? So if we don't prepare as well as we think we should, will God let us starve? How many of you know who this guy is? HMS Richard. How'd you know that? Remember that guy? Great preacher. In 1940, he was in a chicken coop broadcasting the voice of prophecy, right? The little ministry called The Voice. He's in a chicken coop, and he's broadcasting. It's a little ministry. It's a big ministry today, but it's a little ministry back in the 1940s. He was invited by the General Conference to come and speak at the Fall Council. It's a big camp meeting. It's the Fall Council in Grand Rapids, Michigan. It was a big opportunity for HMS Richards for his ministry, and he thought, well, this is important. So he spent months and months preparing just the perfect sermon, right? Have you ever done that, Billy, where you just work and work, and you got to get this just right? You're going to be in front of the General Conference. You're going to be on national television or something, 3ABN or whatever, and you got to prepare this just right. So he worked for months. He had it just right. He was picked up at the train station by the elder, and while they're all riding back to the camp meeting tent, the big tent, you can see the big tent here, he asked the elders, well, he said, who spoke last night and what was the topic? You know, just who spoke? You know, he talks with a deep voice. Who spoke last night? And the elder said, it was F.D. Nichols. Remember that name? Francis Nichols, the editor of the Bible Commentary, SDA Bible Commentary. Big name in Adventism history. Oh, he spoke last night. Oh, what did he speak about? You know, so maybe I can kind of build off that topic on my topic here. Oh, elder said, well, I have his notes. And he handed HMS Richards the notes. HMS Richards said instantly he got a headache. I got this from Morris Vinden, who knew HMS Richards, my old pastor, Morris Vinden. He said instantly HMS Richards got a headache because he said if you had tried, the notes could not have been more identical. They were identical to his sermon. And he knew right then his sermon was no good. Out the door, everything on that sermon was toast. It was toast. It was no good. So right away he said, I got a headache. And I started praying. And I'm going to preach that night, it's the morning time, he's going to preach that night in the camp meeting. He has nothing to say now. And so he's worried about this. He's praying, and God is not answering him. He's letting him sweat it out. Sometimes the best sermons come that way, don't they? When you really are allowed to stress out. So he's praying, and just before the people started coming in, he's in the balcony praying, and he will not stop praying. And finally, he walked out down there. He needed to go up to the front now. He walked out of the balcony, and he said, as he walked through the archway that walked into the hall where he's going to speak, it was like a hand took and scraped his headache right off. It just went right off under the doorway. Have you ever walked through a doorway and forgot something, you know? And you go back under the doorway, and there it comes back. Well, this is what happened to him. His headache, he lost it. And he walked out, and now he was excited, but God still gave him a sermon. He didn't know what he's going to talk about, but he was excited now. And he got up to the front, and they had him all sit down. The king's heralds were there, and they're sitting down, and they're doing all the preliminaries, and he's in his Bible with his one eye, you know, searching his Bible, stressing it out, looking, where am I going to find my sermon? I got to have something to say. So he had the king's heralds come out and sing the special music. Here they are, 1937 King's Heralds. They're singing their lift up the trumpet, you know, and they're doing their thing, and they sing it, and then that's the last thing, and he's supposed to preach. Well, he gets up after they're done singing, and he says, you know what, I'm just thinking, the King's Heralds, they do a song that I just absolutely love. Won't you come out and do, and he gave the number, won't you do this, and do all 10 verses of that, please. You're going to love this. And he goes back to his Bible, and he starts searching for the sermon. Another song. And they're going, what's up, boss? They called him boss. He says, never mind, leave me alone. He told him, leave me alone. Just sing and do all 10 verses. And so he's searching and searching. HMS Richards is praying with no immediate answer. Now that happens, doesn't it? Now, God's timing is amazing. So while going through the mark of the beast trial, will you guys be praying? Will the saints be praying? What are we praying for? We're praying for deliverance, aren't we? This is a time of persecution like never, never before. This is the test that the people of God must have before they are sealed. This is the testing time. All who prove their loyalty to God by obeying his law and refusing to accept the spurious Sabbath will rank under the banner of the Lord God, Jehovah, and receive the seal of God. Every earthly support is cut off. We probably will be displaced, no matter how much preparation we have. We may go a little hungry, but the advice from the Bible is don't give up. Keep praying, because it's a test. Remember that. This is a test. There's a little known, I don't have time to share. Let me just go forward. Okay, well, all right. It's your fault. Okay, good. Not me. I would like to preach. I'd like to start at 9 a.m. if you'd ever let me, and then I can go to 12. A little known fact, what's that? We're getting, no, that's what you got. That's good. You're supposed to think that. Think about HMS Richards. By the edge of your seat. Right, get at the edge of your seat and wait for it. Here it comes. 9 million people starve every year. Did you know that? 9 million people go hungry every year. And starve, they actually die every year. How many of these people that starve to death are born again, committed, Bible-following believers in Jesus? Not one. How do I know that? Because the Bible tells me so. Did you know that not one of God's children, according to the Bible, has ever starved to death, who is committed, born again, and a believer in Jesus? Here's how I know. The Bible says in Proverbs 10:3, the Lord does not let the righteous go hungry. Seek ye the first the kingdom of God. If you do that, guess what the promise is? All these things will be added unto you. Here it is. Bread shall be given him, his water shall be sure. That young man over there said that. These are promises from God. Now, can God lie? Now, this is the thing we're going to cling to at the mark of the beast time, is the promises of God. That's all we're going to have. God will seem to be silent, like he was with HMS Richards, until the last minute. But God says these things, and he cannot lie. You know, God can't die either, right? God can't change. Did you know the Bible says, I'm the Lord, I change not. He can't. And he can't lie. He makes a promise. He can't lie. It's his promise. He cannot force the conscience either. Praise God for that. One person told me, I was, you know, if God is so good, why does he allow people to die? Why doesn't he feed them? And I remember I almost snapped at a guy one time, and he said that. I'm so tired of hearing that. I didn't snap, Billy. I really didn't. But in spiritually, I snapped. I said, why don't you feed him? You know, it's not God that's letting these people starve. It's the devil that is letting them starve. And why are you blaming God? Do you know somebody that's starving? I said, who is that person? Well, there's people that I go, oh, you know about them. Go feed them. What are you waiting for? It's not God's fault. It's your fault. Do you know someone that's starving? Feed them. God hates starvation. And God calls us and gives us the privilege to feed starving people. Two things you can do when you notice somebody starving. And this is what we do in missionary work. We feed them first, and then we convert them second, right? Feed them and convert them so they can access God's promises. God cannot fulfill these promises without the conditions of the promise. Right? God can't do that. He wants to feed you, but he says, seek me first, and then I can do it. He says, be righteous. The righteous will not go hungry. And so you've heard the saying, give a man a fish and you feed him for a day. Give a man a fishing pole and you feed him for life, right? Well, the same idea is with these promises. Here they are again. Trust in the Lord and thou shalt be fed. We read that in our scripture this morning. In the days of famine, they shall be satisfied. I have not seen the righteous forsaken nor his seed begging bread. It doesn't happen because God promises to feed the righteous. He shall deliver them because they do what? Because they trust in him. Remember these promises. These are promises that we're going to need to cling on to during a time of trouble. God's promise to... Yeah, that's Psalm 37 is awesome, isn't it? Psalm 30, in fact, all of Psalm. There's so many promises. The Bible is filled with promises that tell us, I'll feed you, but let me feed you because trust me and follow me and obey me and I can feed you then. You give me permission to feed you. Ministry of Healing, a book I love, and I'm reading it right now. Only as we live in obedience to his word can we claim the fulfillment of his promises. Don't stop praying. Don't give up on your commitment. He that endures till the end shall be saved. What's that? That is in page number 227. Only as we live in obedience to his word can we claim the fulfillment of his promises. These promises are conditional, aren't they? I didn't realize the sermon was so long, so we're going to wrap it up. He's praying, and he's at the end. They come to the last verse of the song, and he's got big eyes on the Bible, and he's thumbing through it. Just as the heralds came to the last line, the last word, he found it. It was in Romans 1. Verses 14 through 16. And he read where it said, I am debtor both to the Greeks and the barbarians, to the wise and the unwise. I am ready to preach the gospel of Christ. And I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. He said, and it came to him, three I ams. I am debtor. I am ready. I am not ashamed. Three I ams. He said it was as if God gave him. He waited to the last second. And God gave him, he said, complete, the illustrations were there. God gave me every illustration. He gave me every Bible text. He gave me the sermon title. It was the most beautiful thing, he said. And he stood up, and he started preaching that sermon, one of the best sermons he's ever preached. You could look it up. I actually preached a sermon called The Three Ams of Paul. I altered it a little, but made it better. But 15 minutes into his sermon, a man in the balcony came down the stairs, walked down the center aisle, and threw down his pipe and his tobacco and knelt down and gave his heart to God. And soon, others are getting up out of he's not even done his sermon. He's 15 minutes in, and they're coming out of the seats. They're coming to the front. They're kneeling, and people are joining that man that threw down his pipe. And so the mark of the beast time is a time to keep praying and to not give up. The devil wants you to give up, but God is asking you to hold on to his promises. Keep praying. This is God's will, that we go right up to the moment where prayer answers are needed. Keep holding fast to your commitment to the end. Be faithful unto death. And what was the promise? A crown of life. Be faithful unto death. And that means the last moment. Be faithful all the way through your life. When you come to that moment of death, be faithful. And you'll receive a crown of life. How many of you would like to receive that crown of life? I think we should make an appeal that if there's anything that stands between you and your commitment to God, that you, like that man, come and throw your pipe down. And that pipe could be, it's probably not tobacco. I don't suppose any of us are struggling with that, but if we are, that would be a good thing to throw down at the altar. But if it's anything that stands between you and your commitment, would you be willing to give that up? You want to make a commitment to God today? I think we should make that commitment today. We don't really do altar calls, and we're already here. Everybody's up at the front. But if that's the prayer in your heart, let's all.
He wasn't doing an altar call, and he came.
Yeah, he just came. He just came down to the front because he felt the Holy Spirit calling him to change his life. And there's a lot of changes that need to be made in our lives before we are ready. And God wants those changes to happen now. Today is the day of salvation. If you hear the voice, today is the day to answer that voice. Don't put it off. You put it off, that's where the devil has his power, is in delay. So each one of us, are we still there on our commitment? Are we there? We're 100% committed to follow God's faith. And so that's good. So now I can come back for part three, George, as long as we're still committed, because I'm going to quit the minute you say, no, I'm not committed anymore. But as long as we're committed, we're going to keep deciding how God can ease the blow when he comes. This is going to be and God wants to do that because he does not want us to starve. He wants us to live. Be faithful unto death, and you will receive that crown of life. Let's pray. Let's kneel. Those of you that would like to, let's join me and we'll kneel. Our loving Father in heaven, thank you for the privilege of serving a God who has given his life for us. And thank you so much, Lord, for revealing so much to us of what it's going to be like at the very end of time. And we just pray, Lord, and we know, Lord, that it's soon, and it's happening soon. And we just praise you, Lord, that you've revealed your secrets unto your servants, the prophets, and we have access to that because you love us. You don't want us to go through hardship and crisis. You'll be with us when we do, but you don't want us to go through that alone. So we thank you, Lord. We pray that you'll bless each one of us. Help us to sort out and organize the goals that we have as far as maybe debt, food, commitment, all these things, Lord, are important to us. Bless us each, Lord, and open the channel of communication between us so that we hear your voice helping us with our plans. And just pray, Lord, that each one of us will have the main plan, as that is to accept your voice and hear your voice and give our lives completely to Christ today. So that's our prayer, Lord. Bless us and keep us. We love you and thank you and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.